have a conversation. How many people here work in government? Anyone? All right, we have one bureaucrat. No, I don't know if you're a bureaucrat. I'm a proud bureaucrat, I say. So we'll get more into that in a few moments. So the talk tonight, The Promises and Perils of E-Policy, and the subtitle is How Do We Keep Democracy Smart with Cute Cats? And the reason I say this is because there's a picture of a cat. Cat memes are very popular online. They're not necessarily what we would consider rational, civilized discourse, but they're very popular. So I want us to think about this as we move forward. One of the things that I also wanted to do is give some examples of tweets. It's a little bit different to read the tweet versus having the tweet appear for you, so I won't go into great detail about them. But I just want to set the context so we're all on the same page. I don't know if you're all active Twitter users, but I'm assuming that you're at least familiar with some of the most common kinds of tweets that we have out there. So one of my first examples is from the @POTUS account in the United States. POTUS stands for President of the United States, which is different than the Donald Trump account. So this is the official account that only the President of the United States can use. And this tweet was from March 7th, and it says, "Don't let the fake news tell you there's big infighting. We're getting along great and getting major things done." Exclamation point. So in addition to the fact that this is probably among the first presidents to ever use exclamation points in tweets, this is also this constant refrain that we hear from this particular president on Twitter about fake news, about the media attacking him and his policies, and that it's not fair, that it is unfair. Another tweet that I wanted to mention was from Hillary Clinton, who, as you know, did not win the election in November, and it just says, "Delete your account." You can imagine who she might be referring to. And then another tweet that I wanted to mention, this is from November 9th, so the day after the election, and it's just from a regular citizen, and it says, "Retweet if you are a woman, an immigrant, LGBT+, Muslim, African-American, Latino, or in any other way completely terrified right now." And this is really captures the spirit that descended upon the U.S. on November 9th. Not for everyone, there was a lot of celebrating in certain parts of the country, but there was a lot of people who felt very fearful about their rights and what would happen. One of the reasons I bring up these examples, though, is that this conversation, this discourse, if you can call it that, is being played out in a public space that anyone can see, and being done so in less than 140 characters. So there's not really much room for elaboration. There's a lot of pictures involved, there's a lot of cats involved. There were no cats in these particular ones, but there are in general. And but they're very easy, it's very easy to capture sort of the spirit of the moment with these very short messages. So my talk tonight, there's gonna be four basic points that I wanna touch on. One is the idea that we could have a wise, smart, informed public sphere. And I wanna talk about what that would look like. I'm not saying that we have it. I'm not saying that we don't have it, but I'm saying if we had it, what would a wise public sphere look like? The second one is about transparency. And I wanted to, the subtitle for this part is Secrecy is for Losers. And this came from a book written by an American senator, Dan Moynihan. And this was back in 1998. And what he said was, look, it's 1998. So it's 1998, it's the future already, was his point. He said, yeah, secrecy is something that is part of the Cold War era. It's something from a past time. It is no longer helping government. It is no longer helping our citizens. We need to embrace transparency, look around, get with the times. Let's make it happen. 1998, here we are almost 20 years later. So we're going to talk about the context, about why transparency is inevitable. And I know that that's not necessarily everyone's opinion, but I'm going to try to make the case for it. The second piece related to that is this slogan called Information Wants to Be Free. And it came from the hacker movement, which I'll get into a little bit later in the discussion. But it's also talking about why having an open government and having open data and having discourse on social media in the public eye is also something that we can't turn back the tides on. But the last question is about complexity. Are we saying goodbye to complexity? Are all of our conversations going to be just 140 character bursts of opinion or whatever happens to be on our minds? So this is where I got my subtitle, Keeping Democracy Smart with Cute Cats. and we try to make the case that we can have complexity even with the tools that we have right now. We just have to be clever about how we do it. There was a picture of a cat there, by the way. Okay, so this is where I get into my my professorial mode for a second, and I have to talk about Jürgen Habermas. So usually when you start a conversation saying, we're going to talk about Habermas, everyone goes, oh. So if this is the time where you want to go, oh, this is okay. You can groan, and I won't take it personally. So can you guys hear me? Do I need to use this microphone?
You do.
Okay, great, because I find that I'm gesticulating wildly, and I'm afraid it's going to go flying across the room. Thank you very much. So we talk about the public sphere as if we all know what it is, but it actually originated with one person's dissertation. Jürgen Habermas in 1962 wrote a book called The Structural Transformation of the Public Sphere. Now, one of the reasons that it was important is that this was the first time that anybody really articulated the notion that there was more to policymaking than just laws and government, but that citizens had just as powerful a role in making sure that the government made laws that represented the people. So he had talked about how in coffee houses, people would gather together, and citizens would engage in what he called rational critical debate using quotation marks. Yeah, I'm gonna keep going, okay. Ignore the sounds. And the screen dropping behind you. So, the idea was that people of their own volition would come together and have coffee. We do this all the time. All right, so we're already in a good shape. And then we would engage in a debate. Not just any debate, though. We were going to be rational creatures, and we were going to think critically about the problems that the world had. And that from these debates of coffee houses and people all over the country, all over the world, would emerge this thing called public opinion. Public opinion, then, would influence legislators who would be forced to enact laws reflecting public opinion. Oh my gosh, there might be time for cats. Very exciting. So, it wasn't just that you could debate anything. You know, we could debate your family matters, or we could debate shoes, or we could debate my kids' education issues. No, it had to be about domains of common concern. So there was all these requirements for what the public sphere had to be. It had to be rational, it had to be involving critical thinking, it had to make sure that there were topics of concern for everyday people. And this would be a check on government, that there would be enough of this happening that government would be forced to comply. So this is really exciting to me because my next set of examples are Duvall pictures. So I'm going to talk about Jürgen Habermas for one more second. Has anyone here ever read The Structural Transformation of the Public Sphere?
No.
Does everyone know what the public sphere is? Yes. So this is one of those examples where we may not. Yay! Okay, so how do I advance the slides? You do it for me? Okay, can you go to the next, go to the slideshow? I just want to show my first slide. See, look, here's my cat. This is my serious cat. I have a serious cat, this is a serious election. This sort of sets the tone for the talk. Okay, so we're going to fast forward through lots of slides until we get to the public sphere stuff. Oh yeah, I missed the one about the Barack friendship bracelet because I didn't know how to describe the friendship bracelet. But this was another great picture of the vice president saying, "Happy 55th, Barack, a brother to me and a best friend forever." And it's a friendship bracelet. And is this a matter of rational critical debate about an area of common concern? I don't know. But here we are. Okay, so you can stop right there. So I'm going to look at some examples of this rational critical debate in 2017. So the first slide, next slide, please. This is a cat. No, sorry, it's a rabbit. Okay, this is all cats. You are beautiful and you will do great today. All right? Next example. This is a spokes dog on BBC News. Finally, an opinion I want to hear. Next slide. Great to see Google takes cow privacy seriously. You see the cow's face has been blotted out because, God forbid, we recognize which cow it is. Next slide. Okay, so obviously these are not really inspiring examples of rational critical debate. But there's another point that Habermas made that is really important to bring up. And I'm going to tie these two together in a minute, so just bear with me. The public sphere is also a way to talk about the distinction between secrecy and what's in public, which he called publicity. Because this is 1962, this is pre-internet, this is pre-social media, pre-memes. And it says, you know, secrecy is supposed to serve the maintenance of the sovereignty. Whoever's in charge use secrecy as a kind of tool to keep them in power. And publicity was supposed to promote legislation based on rational discourse. So this is what I was saying earlier, where you have public opinion that rises up and gives legislators guidance on how they're supposed to legislate. So can you go to the next slide, please? So here's some examples that are actually a little bit more serious. This is a journalist who said, looks like the Trump administration hasn't taken control of the National Park Service Twitter feed just yet. Can you go to the next slide? And this fuzzy picture, the reason it's fuzzy is because it's been deleted and taken down, so finding good examples of it is hard. This is a picture of the inauguration crowd for Obama in 2008. And this is a picture of the crowd that assembled for Trump in 2017. The National Park Service tweeted this out. They're a federal agency. Clearly, they were making a statement and wanted to kind of quietly criticize the fact that not a lot of people supported, or point out that not a lot of people supported the new president. Next slide, please. Another phenomenon that's come out recently is this idea of rogue accounts. Has anyone heard of the rogue or alternate Twitter accounts? This one's called Rogue Federal Employee. So every federal agency at this point has its own Twitter account, sometimes several of them, depending on whether it's personal or institutional. One of the things we saw after this inauguration tweet that I just pointed out was an internal memo, not an executive order, a memo asking all federal agencies to stop tweeting immediately. This is from somebody who tweets constantly, but the sense that this was getting out of his control was very nerve-wracking, so all of the federal agencies were told to stop tweeting, including the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, and other agencies that had information on climate change. So one of the things that they did was they started creating accounts, alternative or rogue accounts, so they could still keep tweeting unofficially. So this is the rogue federal employee account. Can you go to the next one, please? This is where I used to work, the U.S. Mission to the United Nations. It only has 704 followers because it's very new. But this sums up basically the idea behind the movement of alternate or rogue accounts. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world with an unofficial Twitter account. Next slide. So this one here, if you see the yellow box, it's hard to read, but there's 120 rogue Twitter accounts at this point in time. 120. Every agency has at least one. Now, the question is, so what? Is this really going to make a difference? Is this going to change the course of our public debates and public dialogue? It's yet to be seen. But what the rogue accounts do is they tweet out facts and statistics and information that no longer exists on government websites. All of the government websites run at the federal level have been scrubbed for information that does not comply with the Trump agenda. The White House website changed the moment of the inauguration, and it removed all mention of climate change, all mention of the environment, all mention of LGBTQ, all mention of minorities. It's since been modified and updated again, but not to include necessarily all that information. So the rogue accounts are, in some ways, the only way that Americans have access to official data about what's happening in the US. Next slide. Now, I want to introduce another concept after the public sphere. Michael Shutson is a professor at Columbia University, the journalism school, and several years ago, pre-social media, he wrote a book called The Good Citizen. And in it, he talked about how citizens maybe don't have to be involved in politics every day. Maybe that's unrealistic. Maybe what we should hope for is the monitorial citizen. So the idea that, like parents at a pool watching their kids, you don't have to be involved all the time and go to all the town halls and, you know, sign the petitions. Maybe you just have to kind of keep watch. And when something goes wrong, that's when you leap into action, just like a parent at a pool. Be informed enough and alert enough to identify danger to their personal good or danger to the public good. And engage in what he called environmental surveillance instead of information gathering. Whether people actually do this or not is a question for debate, and I hope it's something that we can discuss as we move forward. Okay, next slide. Now I want to talk about secrecy. You'll see the subheading on this one is secrecy is for losers. I just mentioned earlier, that's not my, I stole that, that's not my title. But I did write an article called Secrecy is for Losers, so I'm using this shamelessly everywhere I go, because I love it. One of the reasons that I brought it up here is because, as I mentioned, Habermas talked about secrecy's role in the public sphere was not actually helping citizens. That really what it does is it helps the sovereignty, whichever the sovereignty is, whoever's in power, maintain their power. Next slide, please. And this is the original quote, and this is a book from Senator Moynihan. He said, secrecy is for losers, for people who don't realize how important information really is. And this is where I love this, is 1998. We put openness in peril by poking along in a mode of an age now past, long past. It's so last year, so 1997. Next slide. So before Twitter, before social media, the public sphere really existed in the conversations that people had and how they expressed themselves publicly. Writing op eds, letters to the editors, protests, petitions, etc. And this book by Wilson Dizzard, which is a fantastic history of digital diplomacy, talks about information technologies being the final demise of diplomacy as a profession carried out by elites. And not just elites, but elites that worked with only other elites. Next slide. This is a picture from a screen capture from the Havana Convention on Diplomatic Officers in 1928. And it states that duties of diplomatic officers expressly states that they cannot engage in the domestic or foreign politics of the state. Basically, what that means was diplomats, when they went to another country, were only allowed to talk to other diplomats. They weren't allowed to talk to citizens. That was their mandate. Now, think about that compared to where we are now, where we have people, ambassadors, diplomats, officials of all levels, engaging in public diplomacy. Public diplomacy didn't exist then. Public diplomacy now is a common practice. Next slide, please. All right, so I'm going to make the case here that the internet is a government secrecy crusher. It's going to destroy secrecy in government to a certain extent. I'm being a little bit glib here, but there's a few reasons why. The first one is that digital information is omnidirectional. This is just a visualization to help emphasize and underscore this point. When I send you an email, I'm sending it to you. If I send you a letter, I'm sending it to you. If I put something in the